obviously one thing is that whatever you are doing now, whatever you are learning now, whatever you have achieved now at this particular position, you have got it after quite a grueling selection procedure of exams and interviews as well. So what's the basic qualification for this role?
This particular role is the entry level role in the technical cadre. There is three different cadre. There is admin cadre, technical cadre, and information technology cadre.
So
in technical cadre, this is the entry level job. So it's kind of pay level 7.
Pay
level 7, that means you in hand you will be getting somewhere around 78, and CTC something around 85, something like that. It depends upon the cities, you know, HRA is depending upon the cities. So yeah, so that's one thing. And the basic qualification as per the recruitment regulation is B.Tech, with technical degree, and for science degree it's MSc. In the for those who are trying for the exam in the future, kindly note that in the regulation it has been put out that desired qualification. That desired qualification is considered as GATE and CSIR NET or ICIR NET. So there is a chance in the future, just like how BAS did.
Correct.
BAS completely moved into GATE.
GATE.
Similarly, there is a great chance for FSA also getting into GATE and just taking the toppers out of GATE. So yeah.
Out of GATE.
So those who are preparing or those who are aiming for technical officer or CFSO as a job profile, make sure that you have a good score in the GATE, or who are having MSc, they can target for a high score or high rank in the CSIR or ICIR name.
So obviously, so GATE is opening up a lot of opportunities, and FSSI might be the next one to get on board sir, like, what is the frequency of recruitment or vacancies that is generally seen?
As of now, you know, Department of Personnel Training has Department of Personnel Training and Ministry of Finance has approved around 255 vacancies for technical officer. In general, but you know, the recruitment was only happened for 135 vacancies. So you, as such, there is vacancy, but that will take you know, in government procedure, you can't fill it up for one go. Rather, you know, there's a lot of promotion and those activity to be coming in the future. Right? So to avoid those problems, they keep some certain seats for the future generation as well. So yeah, so there, as of now, there is around 120 seats vacant. Vacancies is there, but the thing is that notification is not there is no set of frequency, because you know, the recruitment procedure one which I get into is still continuing, because there's a lot of vacancy came in between, and this waiting list, people were called up. There should be a separate training for those guys, and then they're assigned work. Now so I think it's almost done as of now, but yeah, notification, we don't know the frequency and window, we don't know when it will be coming, but I hope maybe in next 2 years there will be one more notification coming.
Notification. Okay. And intake is also not fixed, as you're saying, like it can vary according to the
It's up to the FSA. They will look up to the requirement as such. Anyway, as such, as part of from BOPP and the Ministry of Finance, they have approved 255 for technical officers. But yeah, justification of freedom of number of vacancies is always with the person.
Okay. So, but anyways, I think aspirants need to keep themselves on the tip of their toes, that any day the notification can come. So better be safe than sorry later. So obviously, sir, like it's a very much coveted role, and lots of aspirants are there every year. So how did you prepare for this examination? Any tips and strategies?
When the notification came, I was working with more or less as R&D intern, as an R&D intern. You know, it was very difficult time for me, you know, after coming from I used to come or return back to hostel by 8-8:30, then I used to schedule my studies. Anyway, my personal suggestion or my strategy was first of all, I tried to understand the syllabus.
Mm.
So I tried to classify the syllabus into three. That is, first which I doesn't know anything about that, but which I have a 40-60% of understanding. Another one, I have a complete understanding. So I try to classify each and every keywords in the syllabus into these three buckets, and then I started preparation. After classification, then the prioritization happened. That is, I started to prioritize those topics which I need a lot of time to prepare. Most important thing what I did is that, as this is a legal or regulatory kind of examination, I try to network with a lot of law students or lawyers. It is essentially to understand the legal language, because legal language is essentially different from regular from our normal conversations. The thing is that the word shall in our normal language and regulatory language is having a difference. In regulatory language, shall is kind of stressing up, which we use it in a vague way in the normal conversation, right? So I try to network with these lawyers, and as I didn't try to study for CAT, that's why I didn't know how this general aptitude can come in the highly competitive exam. So I try to network with the CAT aspirants and other government students who are preparing for the government job. So that essentially opened up lot of good resources for each and every aspect. For example, even though I was aware about Pitbull's eye for the pure preparation or testing your knowledge, but I didn't know how effective it was, because a lot of CAT students who I met with suggested me to go through this Pitbull's eye website and try to prepare based on that. So this networking essentially opened up a lot of good resources, and they also pointed out a lot of good strategies how to approach each and every aspect. So that was one thing which I did. Then I, as per the points which I got from these connections and from my understanding, I started to look for good resources. Obviously, for regulation and the FSA related aspects, everything is freely available on the website.
Correct.
So my first method was to download all these regulations.
Download
all this material and keep in one point. And then started studying for at least 2 to 3 hours daily. I think it's all about persistent studies, because once you give a break, you come out of that
zone.
Yeah, so consistent studies was done. Then obviously I did this revision. Weekly revision was done by every Sunday. Obviously I did this practice. FSA exam was of two tiers. First one was a computer-based test, and second one was this written test, long answer test. So for this computer-based test, general aptitude was basically prepared by the use of Pitbull's eye, and FSA also provided one website in which this can be tested. I used Sanjeev Sharma's Man University app. Lot of questions regarding food
and say. correct.
That's something which I used for my CBT practice. Then once I cleared with the CBT practice, then I came to know, yes, because I tried to understand how will be the competition. So I came to understand that I am supposed to get a good mark in this one, this as well, this mains examination. So the first method what I tried to do is that I started to go to the syllabus once again and started to make a detailed note for each and every keyword. Each and every keyword was detailedly prepared, and that was my study material for the next step. And I didn't have any prior experiences regarding this examination, normal examination. So what I did is that one of my friends suggested who was preparing for UPSC, he suggested me to try this UPSC kind of method of writing long answers. So he suggested one video of Akshat Jain.
Akshat Jain, topper.
Yeah, topper, yeah. That's when I understood, oh, this is how UPSC guys are
preparing
writing answers very effectively. So I try to follow the same, even though I'm not so perfect in that aspect, but it has essentially helped me in a lot of way to effectively write any particular topic in the examination. And I also started practicing, because, you know, I asked my friends to put some 5 question paper in which I started writing every day. So that essentially helps, you know, once you are in master's or in job, you know, it's very difficult to have a fastness in your writing. So that's what I improved, and also tried to improve my handwriting, because my handwriting was very bad prior to that. So I tried my best, but, you know, at the end in examination, you don't look for beautification, rather you try to put out your knowledge, right?
So
I think, yeah, that's how, and self-motivation, of course.
Absolutely. And it was like, I think it was your first attempt, and you only cracked that one only. So that's commendable. So obviously, one small thing is that you've also given some other government exams like GATE and NET and all these exams. So was this exam a little bit different from that in any perspective?
NET and GATE is just CBT based examination, that's right. So preparation was, CBT examination was quite familiar for me, because I prepared for GATE and NET. But this long answer is something written, which you need to focus a lot, because, you know, it's all about how you present. Because the questions as such, when you if you look into the question paper of FSA's long answer, it's all about what is GMP, you know. So GMP is something which everyone knows, okay. But it's about how you're putting out.
How
effectively put out the answer. So it's very important. You know, you may feel, what is this? This is such a easy topic, but, you know, it's very easy to lose marks in this sort of easy
generic questions.
Yeah, because a lot of people put out a lot of statistics in that, or statistics or some sort of extra points.
Okay. So filtering out the...
I see people putting out infographics or some picture representation of each and everything. So that also helps. I was not aware about that, you know. I was not aware about this page. These pictures essentially helps to score higher marks. But that's a good strategy for anyone preparing for this.
Okay. So infographics, and obviously focusing on the written exam. And overall, you took a lot of actually... insights from different kinds of people, like MBA aspirants, UPSC aspirants. So that's why I think that's why there's a power of networking. I believe every student should believe in, and should always be open towards learning from all kinds of people in different domains. So obviously, sir, you talked about the pay scale. Any special incentives that you get at this particular job at FSSAI?
As particular, you know, not any particular thing, but we are getting all the incentives or all the allowances as any other central government employees.
Central government.
So obviously, there is a difference between central government allowance and state government allowance. So similar role, as in central government, we will get a lot of other allowances. You know, there is something like child education allowance, daily allowance. You get all, and something which excited me was this all India tour allowance.
Okay.
So, so every 4 years you get a chance to travel across any place of your choice. Go there with along with your family. You can get the money back from the office.
Great.
And even like for us people like me who are being posted outside their hometown, they get this yearly leave concession, especially leave travel allowance, when which you get this money, the travel allowance to go to your
hometown.
And even your hometown, and also if your family is coming to your workplace, you can get that allowance as well.
Acha, okay. So a lot of things as well, but not only this, guys, there's a lot of learning involved in this, and also a lot of hard work which goes behind getting this. So obviously it's a last question, one or two last questions. Any advice for the aspirants out there who are choosing to appear for FSSAI examinations?
I think, as in a general way, any food technologists are supposed to understand the basics of food regulatory affairs, because it's an essential skill for any food technologist. You know? Most of the time, we don't take regulatory affairs as a serious aspect. But, you know, with a strong command of food regulatory affairs, you know, you can go to heights, because I've seen people with skills in regulatory affairs have been translated or moving up the ladder very quickly.
Very quickly.
You know, it essentially helps, strong regulatory knowledge can be incorporated while the NPD, new product development. You can save a lot of time, you can save a lot of effort, you can save a lot of money though. Because as few people, like, especially the startup kind of guys, who doesn't look into the regulatory
just.
They have just developed product and come to approval, but then you see that their particular product is having some concerns, especially in concerns regarding the ingredient, concerns regarding the standards. So, you know, why I said that regulatory knowledge along with the NPD will be effective, because, you know, for example, if you are making some chocolate, if you are a startup making some sort of chocolate, there's a defined quality parameters for a chocolate in the food, in the FSS product standards. So, you know, that's very important to understand that and then making the product as per that. So that's something too. So when you speak regarding this examination, everyone try, if you're a BTEC graduate, try a BTEC student, make sure that you prepare for the gate, because, you know, maybe in the future, just like BAS did, FSA can also come up with that examination, just take based on GATE. So GATE is very important, guys, for those who are doing it. For masters, those who are having degree as MSc, so kindly look, kindly start taking ICAR, Metro, CPSAR very seriously, because that will also help in another way. And also be attentive regarding these offerings, because it can come at any particular point. So make it a habit that as part of knowledge updation, it's I request everyone of you to go to the FSA website, try to understand all this regulation, try to understand different rights as a consumer. You as a consumer have a right to give complaints, or if you are not happy with the product or the safety of the product, then you can always complain in the Food Safety Connect. So always look for those aspects. You are certainly learning a lot of things while in the process. And obviously, once the notification comes, you can follow the steps I followed, or even you can always ping me. I can help you with all these aspects.
So thank you, sir, for giving the open offer. I think you'll be getting a lot of calls and texts very soon from the community that we address. Obviously, the last question, that's the million-dollar question. For any budding food engineers, how to choose between a government opportunity and a private FMCG role? Like, any indicators or advice that you might want to give to the aspirants? What should they look for in a career before going for any job? What should they actually look for?
Okay, so majority of the food technologists does this mistake. Okay, they doesn't understand their passion as such.
Correct.
They just want some sort of job. Okay, so even I was in that particular position back 1.5 years ago, when I was trying for some job. I was looking for every sort of opportunity. Like, I was looking for management training in some other industry, it's not a sector. I was looking for quality professional. So I'm not saying quality is bad, rather quality was not my passion. So but someone asked, I think it was my mentor, asked me, why are you looking for all these jobs, whether you are always passionate about R&D, why don't you look stick with this thing? So I think every budding food technologist should find his or her passion, and then prioritize the job as per that. Because if you are not having any passion regarding this geography, you will end up regretting that. You know? In my case, I was interested to learn or read a lot of stuff and try to understand a lot of complex aspects. That's why I had that as well. Then I chosen food, sorry, NPD or R&D as my field of interest. So that's one thing which you should do. See, indicators as such, you know, you should understand that not every government job and not every private job can certainly help you, right? For example, there are some government jobs in which you are not learning any technical skills, rather you will be doing some monotonous roles. So it's very important to understand that job description and also kind of organization what it is. There is like both government and FMCG sectors are, and there are a lot of companies or organizations in which the culture can be kind of toxic or the growth is very low. So I think if you are looking for a good growth in any particular sector, I think it all starts how you are selecting a company. For example, if any other company is giving particular role, and then you're seeing that people are growing, like if you LinkedIn is a powerful tool, you can always search in that. If there are a lot of people like growing or going up the ladder in 2 or 3 years, that means that particular organization is recognizing its ability, and then there is a lot of growth happening. But there are a lot of government organizations where in which government organization and private as well, where this that growth is kind of stagnant or very slow. So yeah, so it is very important if you are while selecting the job, be it FMCG or not. It's all about you, like you can, it's you should start thinking whether you are okay with government or if you are interested in private sector, because you know private sector as in general, if you're working very hard, you can grow or go over the ladder very fast. You know, there people look for abilities, or not even it's all about your hard work. But in government is kind of qualified, right? Everything is qualified, so promotion will be on basis of this structure or system put by the BOPD or any other organization. So yeah, so it depends how you do. For me, this was a golden opportunity to learn stuff. You know, food regulatory is a beautiful field of work or sector field where you can learn a lot of new stuff. And it's essentially a technical skill where which you are going to be an expert over a period of time. So for me, it was about learning. And before selecting this, I had talked to a lot of employees in FSA. So I got a very positive response or positive review of this organization, because you know, as it, if you come to this organization, there are a lot of colleagues of mine who comes from different organizations, government organizations, even from state and other central government organizations. So you know, the way they put out regarding FSA was something commendable. You know, there are other organizations in which they have, everything was super slow, kind of typical offices. But in FSA, it's not kind of that, you know, it's very fast, everything is the kind of corporate kind of system, you know, you work very hard, you work, it depends upon, you know, work, everything is based on work. If you complete your work, you can go. It's kind of
that. Correct, you know. Correct. Flexibility and both dynamic atmosphere is there.
Learning is there, correct. I value for learning, because learning is something which makes you exciting.
Correct. So obviously, ending with what Salman sir had only started about the learning curve, that learning curve should go hand in hand and parallel to your experience curve. So ending with that, thank you so much Salman sir for giving us this time and enlightening us and our viewers about the opportunities in this field of food safety and regulatory affairs, and hope we'll meet again very soon.
Yeah, sure, no problem. So guys, if you like, thanks a lot Foodgenics first of all for giving me such an opportunity. I've been seeing your growth since last two years, I think.
Yeah, correct.
No, I've been, you guys have been doing wonderful job, you know, commendable work. You know, when I was preparing for GATE, there was no such organization or a group of people who gave quality education. So I think you are doing something commendable. I think student community are happy with your work, and the results are there. I have seen your posts in LinkedIn, where which you have posted that your students are there in are self in IITs, ICTs. So getting that, I think there are 5 members from your aspect, right?
Yeah, ICT, we have almost like 8 people, ICT
wow,
Mumbai.
That's such a commendable work.
Kharagpur, we have 2, Guwahati, we have 1, so.
Guwahati also, so you have done a commendable work and congratulations for your team too. So yeah, so happy to associate with you guys. And if you have any sort of, if you require any sort of guidance, especially for those student community, kind of connect with me in LinkedIn.
Absolutely.
I will try my maximum to help you. Know. I don't assure that I'll be completely helping you, rather I can guide you because I'll be tagged with other works as well. So yeah, I can help you. I can be mentoring you in a basic way. So yeah, always happy to help you out.
Absolutely, guys. So we'll just attach the contact details of Salman sir in our description below. He's a busy man, but still, when you get the chance to speak to him, just reach out to him. He's a very helpful mentor. So that's it from our side, Shubham and Salman sir, signing off Foodgenics.